Oh, good evening, everybody. Man, I am feeling rushed, is what I'm feeling. Welcome back to the channel. Oh, thank you for bearing with me today. I thought that that preliminary hearing might be a couple hours long. No, it was 5 hours long. And it was more than that. It went from, it was scheduled to start at 1:15 and it ended at about 6:45. So yeah, we're 5.5 hours long. Glad that I can take some time here. We're talking about the murder of Rebekah Byler. These are some photos from the scene the morning of February 26th, just about 3 weeks ago, out at the Byler farm. I do not have any photos of our victim here because of her culture. There aren't any photos of her. But the photo that I do have, actually, this photo right here becomes very important as we get into my report of the preliminary hearing. But the photo that we do have is this man. His name is Shawn Cranston. He's 52 years old from Corry, PA, and he is the suspect in this crime. I want to just say, of course, that he is the suspect. He is the person that has been arrested and charged, and I came away from today's hearing really grateful to the Pennsylvania State Police and the Crawford County Prosecutor's Office and the Public Defender's Office for the process, for working hard through the process to bring these charges to the person that they believe committed this crime. I will cut to the chase and I will say, after the preliminary hearing, I feel that there is certainly enough evidence to move forward prosecuting Mr. Cranston. It doesn't mean that I automatically think he's guilty, but I have been convinced that there certainly is enough to prosecute him. So let me actually just show you something real quick. Make sure that it's showing up. Yes. Okay. Couple things. Number one, if you go to my website, gavinfish.com, and you click on cases and Rebekah Byler, you'll see this photograph, which is just an AI, imagination, an Amish woman. Anyway, you click on Rebekah, you will get to this case page. And all the documents that I have in this case, including my notes from today, I have uploaded there for my patrons. So you guys can go there and you can see my notes. I have not gone through, I have not done any spell checking. I've not done any grammar checking. I haven't done anything. These are the notes that I took as I was in the preliminary hearing. And the hearing went so long that my laptop battery died. Fortunately, I had a pen and a notebook and was able to write the last couple of pages up, which I put into my notes when I got home. So all of my notes are in this document right here, for my patrons to be able to see. And don't worry if you're not a patron, we're going to go through this document in this video today. The other thing that I wanted to show you, this is going to be really meta because I'm going to actually be showing the video as it's going. But you guys will notice that there is a little join button right here. I am now doing memberships on the channel. YouTube has wanted me to do it for quite some time, and I finally decided to do it. So if you would like to have a fun little icon next to your name and get a couple of perks associated with being a member, please click the join button and you can support me in my dream to someday be a full-time YouTuber, which I think is a long way off, but I enjoy doing it and I really deeply appreciate your support. Okay, last thing. And I know I'm not supposed to plug at the beginning of a video. That's dumb. I should wait until you guys are hooked and then go in there. I just want you guys to remember, a quick reminder that if you're on Facebook and you want to join our ragtag merry little group of true crime aficionados, just go to Facebook and search the fish tank. I'm going to do it real quick here so you guys can see. And yeah, I mean, we got a growing little group, 220 members, and we are, I don't know. We're just like-minded people in our little group talking about true crime. So feel free to head over there and join us there. And thank you very much to my mods, Autumn and Jamie, for running that group, and Heidi, and for being a mod here on YouTube. Okay, guys, that's enough, right? That's enough. It's enough, Gavin. Get into the meat of things. Okay, these are my notes. We're going to use them to kind of, and yeah, it's 16 pages. So I don't know. We're not going to read the notes. I mean, I was there. I'm going to report on it. I'm going to use these as my, I guess, my reminders. Okay. So the Crawford County Judicial Center sits next to their courthouse. Their courthouse was built in the middle of the 20th century. The Judicial Center is new. I don't know, probably built in the 80s or 90s or something like that. It certainly is decorated like it was built in the 80s or 90s, but it means that there is good audio and good video in the courtroom. So I arrived to the Judicial Center a few minutes after noon. They were dead serious. Tip staff was dead serious at the Judicial Center that we must follow the decorum order. And so they made sure that my phone was off, that I understood that I wasn't to do any interviews of anybody, which I wouldn't do anyway. But I got up to the fourth floor, and in the lobby, because I was way early, there basically were two groups of people. There was one group of people that the Amish would call English people, right? Non-Amish, basically. And then there were some Amish folks. And the Amish folks, obviously you can tell who they are, but their comportment is different than most of us. They're quiet. They're not overly rambunctious. They were just kind of sitting there. Let's see. The court was really kind, I noticed, to the Amish folks. They were escorted into another room a couple minutes before the preliminary hearing started, and I could see through a window. The court staff were talking to them. But we got made entry into the courtroom at about 12:30. I think it was right at 12:30. They had us walk in a single file line, and each person individually was interviewed and asked, do you have any food or drink with you? Do you have a phone on you? Is it turned off? Those kinds of things. They were dead serious about it. Okay. The court got, started to get really full. If you're sitting in the gallery looking toward the bench, kind of the front left-hand side was set aside for members of or loved ones, family members of, and I didn't talk to any of them because I was prohibited from doing so. And I kind of felt like it was inappropriate at the time anyway. But that front row, I think, was set aside for Mr. Cranston's friends and family. I think there were five people there, including a woman who I took to be his mother. I also think that there was a woman there that I recognized from Facebook as being his wife or his significant other. And then behind them was seated the press. There ended up being seven of us from like the Cory Journal and EYT to an Erie News Now to the Associated Press. We're all just kind of there. And then behind us was mostly empty. There were other people that were there in the gallery. On the left side of the courtroom, the first bench was empty. And then there were 3.5 benches of Amish folks. And they were packed in there. I think there were 25 or 30 of them there. And then that first bench became full as witnesses came in, gave their testimony, and then joined back in the gallery. So at the end of it, there were like four rows of people from Rebekah Byler's life that occupied those benches. Now, in the well of the court, if I can just kind of paint this picture, because video isn't allowed. It's a very typical courtroom. There are two tables up front. The one, as I'm facing the bench, the one on the left was for the defense. The one on the right was for the prosecution. And then there was a jury box. And then there was the bench, right? At 1:13, Mr. Cranston was brought into the court. He was wearing dark colored scrubs, and you guys have to forgive me. I'm so severely colorblind. I don't know if they were navy or dark green or even black. I don't even know. On top of his scrubs, he was wearing a bulletproof vest. He was shackled. His legs were shackled. His hands were cuffed and then shackled to his waist. He was bald with closely cut hair, kind of like we see. I mean, his hair on the sides was longer than this. But I mean, that's what he looks. He had glasses perched on his forehead, and they brought him in. When they did that, one of the members, I think it may have been his wife, but I'm not sure, whispered in a whisper loud enough for us all to hear, whispered, "Jesus." Like she was shocked to see him brought in that way. Other than that, man, the courtroom was dead silent. Mr. Cranston has several tattoos that could be seen. His left arm was in a full sleeve. I couldn't see the right arm. He was seated on the table on the left-hand side of the well, in front of the bar, between two members of his counsel. And you'll have to forgive me, guys, because I didn't take the time. Well, I didn't really have the time trying to get this all figured out. But I'm going to look it up as we kind of go along here, because it's important. But I want to know who his counsel is. I imagine that he is represented by a public defender, which most of us would be. So let me just look this up real quick off screen. Okay. Wow, the case is already shows as closed on the UJS website, which means they didn't waste any time. Okay, so the judge who presided was Judge Amy Nichols. Mr. Kern from the public defender's office is representing Mr. Cranston. Mr. Kern is a, 50-something man, maybe early 60s, kind of a slender guy, dressed well and with salt and pepper gray hair. And then Paula DiGiacomo was the prosecuting attorney. And I believe that she is the Crawford County DA. Let me just look at this. Yeah. So she has been, what is this? Served as the, she's the first assistant district attorney, if she is the attorney. I think she is the district attorney. Both Ms. DiGiacomo and Mr. Howe were seated at the prosecutor's table. Okay. All right. So these are the people that were representing the people. Let me see if I can get a picture of Mr. Kern real quick. Man, I am having a real hard time copying and pasting here. Gary Allen Kern, Esquire. Yeah, I don't know that we're going to get any images of him. Let's see. No, I don't recognize any of those. So anyway, Mr. Kern was representing Mr. Crawford, Cranston, and then Ms. DiGiacomo was representing the people. Judge Nichols arrived very late. There were two Amish men that entered the courtroom that I thought was Andy Byler, but it turned out not to be. Judge Nichols came in at 1:44. Said that they had a conversation in chambers before the preliminary hearing and that the four charges still stand. The charges are, actually, we can look at this. the docket sheet here real quick. Criminal homicide of an unborn child, burglary, overnight accommodation. So it's a house, and criminal trespass are the charges against him. It's interesting that that's an F1. That's not shown as an H1 that's really interesting. That normally we see that as H1 here in the Commonwealth. All right. So the charges remain the same, but the witnesses have been sequestered. So anybody who is going to be a witness in the preliminary hearing, they were not there. And I think that they were all separated from one another. I think that's what they meant by sequestered. I don't know. First witness was Andy Byler. Andy, it was like Judge Nichols came in. She said the charges are the same, and then let's get going. So like a minute later, Andy Byler comes in. Young man, short beard, Dutch haircut. They all tend to have the same haircut. It's like it's combed down. It's kind of like I call it a Pete's Dragon haircut, but I'm old and love Disney movies. Kind of a Dutch boy haircut. Said he's 24 years old. Lives at Fish Flats Road with his wife, their children. He said the morning of February 26th, he said he got up around 7:30. He went out and did some chores in the barn. Rebekah was doing laundry. Let's remember this photo right here, right? She was doing laundry. Let me see. I think there's a wider shot that I have it of it as well. Where is that? There it is. So you can see the laundry on the line out there in front of the FSU van. Okay, so Rebekah was doing laundry, and Andy was going to go out looking for jobs. And he was picked up by Julie Warner. And I think I've described this before, but there is a trade out here in Western Pennsylvania called Amish hauling. It is basically a taxi service. The Amish will pay non-Amish people to drive them to wherever it is that they need to go. And this morning, Andy was going out to bid jobs. He is a roofer, and so he was going out to bid jobs. And in the car with him was a woman named Julie Warner. She was the hauler that day. And a neighbor named Dan Byler, who is of no relation, according to Andy, was also there. So the three of them were picked up by Julie, and Julie and Andy and Dan were all together for the rest of the morning. After they went to, he said they went to Sagertown, and then they later went to the area of Utica, he said. Julie later said that it was Polk, but it's basically Venango County. After they did that, they came home, they dropped off Dan Byler, and then who was just up the street, and then went to drop off Andy. So Andy says that he walked in, and the kids came, I think he said the kids came out, but he didn't mean outside. Just they came to where he was and told him what happened. He walked in and saw Rebekah Byler's white cap, her bonnet, laying on the floor, and saw her lying there. He went back outside and he told Julie. Julie called 911, and they stayed outside waiting for the police to come. This is according to his testimony. This, by the way, I'm not saying that this is what happened. This is what the testimony was. And that's a distinction with a very important difference, okay? So they stayed outside for the police to come. They asked him questions like, do you know Shawn Cranston? No. Do you know anybody, or did anybody with that name have permission to enter the home that day? No. So they're establishing, okay, this is trespass, this is burglary, right? They asked if there was would anybody in the home wear sneaker type shoes? He said no. Would anybody in the house have rubber type black gloves? He said no. And then they asked him, did anything strange happen before this day? He said 3 weeks before the murder, And I have to say, like, this guy, Andy, he kept his composure so well during his testimony. Like, I was really impressed. He had a thick Amish accent. You could understand him, but it was definitely an Amish accent. He answered very directly, yes or no questions. In fact, all the witnesses that day that were Amish answered very directly, very succinctly. Anyway, they asked him if anything happened before the murder, and he said that there was this time about 3 weeks before the murder that a guy came out to the house late at night with his lights out, is what that's supposed to say. He shut the vehicle off. Andy said he and Rebekah were, and the kids were all in bed already. He came outside and confronted the man. And he said this was all like 10:30 at night. And the man said that he was interested in buying the house and that he'd stop by the next day at 10:30. But the man never came out. When asked if he knew what this person that came by the house 3 weeks before looked like, he said he's not 100% what he looked like. He had a beard. He had a bald head. Okay. He was a short guy. He was heavy set. He thinks he was the defendant, but he's not 100%. That's what he said. So it's possible that Shawn Cranston was at that property 3 weeks before the murder. Okay, under cross-examination, Andy, who again kept his composure so well, guys, I can't even tell you. Mr. Kern asked him, when you went out, what was Rebekah doing? She was at the house, she was doing the laundry. He asked some questions about Julie Warner. And Julie was apparently, she was Andy and Dan's hauler. She came every day. And so he asked him a few more questions about that. And basically, she hauls us to wherever it is that we need to go. He does roofing. He's a roofing guy. He said he's not related to Dan Byler. Dan, he thinks, is about 29. Said that he does not know Shawn Cranston. Said that he didn't fully enter the house the day that that Rebekah was killed, but that Julie did. And then he reiterated that Julie and Dan were with him the entire morning. And at that point, he was excused from the witness stand. He was told that he could either leave the room or he was welcome to stay. So he sat in the aisle seat in that front row on the right of the court during the proceedings as it kept following. It's got to be extremely hard. It's got to be extremely hard, guys, because that kind of hearing is really, what's the word? It's just so matter of fact. There's no, it's like there's no room for emotion on this. It is, we need to prove to the judge that we have probable cause to move forward here. And so it's got to be really difficult on the family of the victims here. He did from time to time break down in very quiet sobs throughout the rest of the hearing, and family and friends around him. And I think one person who even worked for the court, they have victims advocates that work at the court, would give him tissues and so forth. It was really hard to see. Okay. Let's see. Wisdom Sleuth 777. Oh yeah, I don't believe him even saying that she was hanging out laundry. He could have done that. It's all about faking and staging a timeline, in my opinion. Your opinion is that Andy Byler killed his wife? Is that your opinion? because then how convenient, you have witnesses and an alibi for the whole day. Okay, so wisdom, we're going to get to the time of death, okay? We're going to get there. Thank you very much for the comment. Okay, so witness number two was Dan Byler. He was sworn in about 159, looks a little older than Andy. He had a much more American accent, brown hair, said he's 30 years old. He does construction work, lives down the street from Andy. He knows Andy and Rebekah, has known them since they moved in June or so of 2003. Keep in mind that these two men are not relatives. Well, they might be relatives, but they're not like close relatives. They might be related somehow because they're small communities, but anyway, he said that he's known them since June of 2023 when they moved into the neighborhood. And he points out for the judge where Andy's house is on the map, where his house is on the map. He says on that day, he did his chores in the morning and then he walked to Andy's around 8 o'clock. He thought that they were going to an actual job for work, found that Andy was still in bed, talked with Rebekah, who got him up. So you can see that the witness testimonies are a little bit different from one another, right? So he said that Rebekah was doing the laundry when he arrived. So now we've got another witness saying laundry was being done. He said that he went back to his place to, when Andy wasn't ready, when Julie wasn't there, he walked down to the creek because he said they had just stocked it with fish. So he was going to check it out, see what the fish situation was down there. He saw Julie arrive, then he walked back up to the Byler's property. This is the Byler's there on the corner of Fish Flats Road and Sportsman Road, I think is what it's called. After Julie picked them both up, they went back to his place and got a ladder at his place. Then they drove to Spartansburg, where they were going to go to the bank, but it was closed. Then they went to Sagertown. Then he said they went to Utica. So I think both Andy and Dan thought they were in the Utica area. They were close. They were close. They were in Venango County. He said that they went home around 12:25 to 12:30. Julie was still driving. Dan was dropped off at his house. Then Julie and Andy drove back toward Andy's house. Under cross-examination by Mr. Kern, he reiterated that he thought that he was going to actually work that day, but it just turns out that they were going to go look at jobs is how they described it. But when asked, he said, yeah, they give free quotes about what a job will cost. One job was in Sagertown. One job was in the Utica area. They got the call for the Utica one while they were in Sagertown. Julie is Julie Warner. All three were together all morning. Nobody else was with him. And then he was dismissed. And he sat right next to Andy. So it was these two young Amish men in the front row. By this point, Andy was already tearing up a bit. But I have to say, while you could tell like people around him cared about him, everybody on that side was really stoic, really, really reverent, I guess, is how I would describe that. Third witness of the day was Julie Warner. Julie is the hauler, right? She was sworn in at 207. She is a blonde woman. She's heavy set. She comes from Titiute, which is, I think Titiute is still in Crawford County. I love that town. Kimberly and I looked at a place before we bought this one that was this really cool old historic home on a 2-acre parcel with another 13 acres of island in the Allegheny River. And we didn't buy it because Kimberly was afraid that the kids would fall into the river and be swept away, which I'm really glad that we got this house. Anyway, Titiute is a cool little old historic town. I think it's in Crawford County. She said she knows Andy, Rebekah, and the children. She drives Andy every day, and she has been doing that for about 3.5 years. That is pretty common, guys. Once they find somebody who will provide this hauling service for them, they stick with them unless there's some kind of problem, right? So on February 26th, she testified that she went to Andy's house, picked him up to take him to go and measure roofs. So she knew that they weren't going to actually work. They were going to bid jobs. She said she arrived at 8:10. She went and got a ladder in the barn. And then once she had Andy and Dan together, they went to Dan's place to get one more ladder. She testified they went to Spartansburg to go to the bank. It was closed. Then they went to Sagertown and measured a roof. Then they went to Polk and measured another roof. So Polk, I can understand why they thought it was Utica, because I think from where they were, they probably would have taken that Utica cutoff off of State Route 8, I think is what that is. Or is that 322? I think that's 322. I can't remember. Anyway, but they would have gone by the Utica area to get to Polk. So I think that that part of their testimony is just fine. Let's see. They stopped at Buell's Corners to get gas. I don't know if you guys remember. Do I still have these photos? I don't. But you'll remember I did a video where the state police were looking for two men, and they had pictures of them from a convenience store. And I thought, hey, that's probably Buell's Corners. It was Buell's Corners where they did that. Anyway, so they went to Buell's Corners to get gas for her car. She dropped off Dan and then got to Andy's house at about 12:15. Andy went into the house to get paperwork. She said to do taxes. I think that's what she said. I'm kind of questioning that at this point because she wasn't the most loudly spoken person. But anyway, she did say she went into the barn, and while she was out there, Andy came out and yelled, "His wife is dead." She went to try to calm him down, asked where the kids were. Quote, he kept saying, what is he going to do? She's in on the floor. She said they'd get the kids, then call 911. She called 911. The children were still in the house. She went to the inside door. So there's like a little entrance way, like a pantry is how one trooper described it. And then you go into like the dining room kitchen area. So she said she went to the inside door and called the children, and they came out, and she sat them down at the edge of the porch. She then asked the lady on 911 if she should go back in and check Rebekah's pulse. And she said, the dispatcher said, yes. So she did go back in and she touched Rebekah, but she ended up just not being able to do it. So she told the 911 operator that she was cold. They asked her specifically what shoes she was wearing, and she said she was wearing Hey Dudes. It was really kind of funny because the defense attorney didn't know what that was. But she said that laundry was on the line when she got there that morning at 8:10. She did not see Rebekah when she picked Andy up. Okay, Mr. Kern crossed. What are Hey Dudes? And she said, they're loafers. And then she reached down and grabbed one off of her foot and held it up. It was really funny. Judge Nichols goes, the court knows what Hey Dudes are. She reiterated that laundry was still on the line when they returned. She reiterated that she did not see Rebekah in the morning. She said, reiterated again, that she picked up Dan at Andy's. He was walking up the road when she got there. Nobody else was with them that morning. She said she went into the residence while she was on the phone with 911, could tell that Rebekah's body was closed because she had touched her. She said the children were playing with their toys inside the dining room when she went inside. And with that, Julie Warner was dismissed. She sat down in the gallery next to Dan. Okay, the next witness was a woman named Rebekah Byler, but not the victim, Rebekah Byler. It's spelled R-E-B-E-C-C-A. She was a young woman, looked to me. She walked in really apprehensively. She wore a white bonnet, and she stated that she lives on Fish Flats Road. She's 31 years old. She knows Andy and Rebekah Byler's house. They live down the road. They live on the same side of the street. She said on the 26th, she was sitting at her sewing machine that morning. I saw a red Jeep pass our house, she said. And she testified that the Jeep passed the house at 10:30 a.m. By the way, this is something that has been in the news, the whole red Jeep thing, right? And it's really kind of funny because when I talked with the state trooper who's the CSO, the basically the public affairs officer. She's like, you know, don't believe everything you hear. Like, well, this was really the only thing we heard. And it was true. I hate it when they try to do that kind of controlling stuff. But anyway, she said that the Jeep passed the house at about 10:30 in the morning. She said that somebody stopped at her residence. It was two men in a white pickup truck and a lime green trailer wanting to sell them a buggy. And the reason that she talked about this, I think, was because like stuff out of the ordinary happened that morning. And so she remembered. She remembered it. She remembered times and so forth. So the men wanting to sell them a buggy happened after the red Jeep came by. The buggy was on a trailer. It was a damaged buggy. It was like the running gear of a buggy. They wanted to sell it to her husband. They didn't buy it. The men drove away. They came by later going the other direction. She saw them from her sewing machine inside the house. She was asked if she knows a John or a Shawn Cranston. I believe her answer was that she did not. I didn't write that down. She'd said she did see the person driving the red Jeep. He had white hair, was bald on top. He was a white male. She said she just got a glimpse of him, did not see any facial hair. She did not recognize him in the courtroom. Under cross by Mr. Kern, she said that she knew Andy all of her life, and she knew Rebekah ever since I remember. She said that Andy is her first cousin, said that Dan is actually her second cousin, and that the guys selling the buggy happened at 11 or 11:30. They talked to her husband, Lester. He was home with her all morning, does not know the names of the men trying to sell the buggy, does not know them. She testified that the sewing machine is inside the house and the house is about 100 feet from the road. Then she was dismissed. Okay. Let's see if... I think I'm just going to keep going. Otherwise, we're going to be here for 5 hours. But okay. The witness number five was a... trying to think. Yeah, she was Amish. She was kind of heavy set, blonde woman in her 30s, sworn in at 2:30. She said she's familiar with Fish Flats Road and Sportsman Road. Her brother used to live there. She was in the area the morning of the murder. She had picked up her sister and passed Rebekah and Andy's home at about 10 to 10:15 in the morning and saw a red car parked in front of Andy and Rebekah Byler's house. She said she knows Rebekah and Andy. She used to teach Rebekah. Knew that they lived there. She was driving a horse and buggy. She does not know what kind of vehicle the red vehicle was. If she saw a photo of it, she could identify it. Quote, I don't know types, I think is what she said. So at that point, Ms. DiGiacomo showed her exhibit number one and asked her, is this the type of car that she saw? And she said, yes. They entered the exhibit into the record. Mr. Kern asked her to reiterate a couple things, asked her about picking up her sister. Does she know the house number that her sister lives on? She didn't. She said that her sister was with her when they passed Andy Byler's house in their horse and buggy. She's familiar with Andy, doesn't really know him. She said that she didn't see the license number of the Jeep and that the license was facing the creek. So the front of the car was facing the road is what her testimony was. She didn't see any bumper stickers on the car. She didn't notice any dents or scrapes on the car. Didn't notice any stickers. She was asked to describe the Byler property. She says there were two buildings there, a house and a barn, and the Jeep was parked right in front of the house. No, there were no other vehicles that she saw. By the way, let me see if I'm going to go over to my photos here. See if I can find the one that it's not in this photo, but when I was there that morning, there was a white pickup truck parked just out of frame to the right of this photo. I think I purposefully cut it out of frame when I was there that day, there were three cars in the driveway there. This one was on the street. this one was in the driveway, and then there was a white cruiser there in front of the garage, and then over by the barn was that white pickup truck. I don't know why I brought that up, but okay, anyway. The white pickup truck belonged to Julie Warner. Okay. She said she hadn't seen the vehicle before. She doesn't know Shawn Cranston. I'd never seen him before. Couldn't tell if the vehicle was running. Didn't see anyone get into or out of the vehicle. She said the day the weather was nice, the sun was shining. On redirect, he asked if there were others in the buggy, and she said her kids were there, her sister's kids were there. It was a covered, like, winter-style buggy. And after that, she was dismissed from the witness stand, and she sat down next to Julie. At this point, this is actually the point that I start to see Andy being given tissues, sitting there crying. Okay, witness number six was a guy named Michael Paul Sweet. He was not an Amish person. He was sworn in about 2:40. He said he's 45 years old. He's a truck driver. On the day in question, he went to a doctor's appointment with his buddy, was in the waiting room, and he had a buggy to sell. So this is one of our buggy salesmen. He was referred to Lester, who we talked about earlier. Lester wasn't really interested. He stopped in at Buell's Corners. He was referred to Dan Byler. So they went back, and tried to sell it to Dan Byler, but he wasn't home. They went through Fish Flats Road twice that morning. And basically the most important thing I think there was that he did see the red Jeep sitting in the driveway of the house the first time when they went and tried to sell the Jeep to Lester Byler. The second time, he doesn't remember what it was. He did corroborate the previous witness that they were driving a GMC pickup hauling a green trailer. He said the red Jeep was like a Compass or maybe a Grand Cherokee Laredo. Mr. Giacomo showed him the exhibit, and he said, yeah, that was the vehicle. He noticed the color and wheels. Under cross-examination, he reiterated that that doctor's appointment was in Spartansburg. Thinks it was Spartansburg Healthcare. Thinks it was Dr. Alan Minky. I don't think I spelled that correctly. And then they went from the doctors directly to Fish Flats Road to meet Lester Byler. When asked about the orientation the vehicle was pulled in, he said he saw the side and rear. So his testimony was that it was pulled in, like opposite from the way the other witness described it. He didn't see any scratches, stickers, or anything distinguishable. He didn't see anybody getting in or out of it. And then he did testify that they did sell the buggy that day. When he was dismissed, he did not sit down in the gallery. He left the courtroom. Witness number seven of the day was a young woman speaking in an Amish accent, wearing a white bonnet. She was sworn in at 2:51. She lives a little farther away. She does know Andy and Rebekah Byler, where they live, and she knows a John Cranston. Okay, this is the first time we have anybody that says anything about knowing anybody connected to the Cranstons. And actually, when I'm finished with Clara, we're going to get to a couple of your comments here because I've been going a while. Okay, so a man named John Cranston, not Sean, but a guy named John Cranston, has been to their house a couple of times talking to her father. There was another Amish man that lived with her family named William Byler, and John was a taxi driver that William had hired. So he was an Amish hauler. She also said that she knows Shawn Cranston, John's dad. And she had two very specific dates that she remembers meeting Mr. Shawn Cranston. The first was December 7th, 2023. She drove with him. He drove her and several others and dropped her off at a friend's house. Apparently they had called John to do the hauling, but he wasn't available. So Shawn came and did it. Shawn was driving a black pickup truck. John was also in the truck, she said. So I don't know why he couldn't do it. And then he ended up being in the truck. I don't know. So it was her, her dad, and her mom. Shawn was doing the driving that day. And then about a month later, January 11th, Shawn came to the house. This description was really weird. Shawn came to the house. He was dressed in black and he had a gun on his side. She said he was there for 5 to 10 minutes. He wasn't really talking. He was just looking out across the field. Then he said that he wanted to go to church with them. He asked when church services were, said, basically the communication was, yeah, I'll be there, but if I'm not there by 8 in the morning, I won't be going. So, and then they went back to the December date, the 7th, and she remembered that after picking her back up from a friend's house, her and her mom, and driving them back to their home on the 7th, Shawn Cranston had said that he wanted to get permission from another property owner nearby to hunt on their property. Their names were Owen and Mary Byler. And she had, it had just stuck with her. That had stayed with her. She was asked if she sees Shawn Byler in the courtroom. And actually, guys, this was something that was something else. It's like, I don't know what was going on through her mind, but I think her face, by looking at her face and her body gestures, it looked like she had just been in a zone on testifying and was not looking around. And when she was asked if the man who she knew as Shawn Cranston was in the courtroom, she kind of sat up straight and started looking around. She was looking in the gallery first. She was looking way back. Like, she looked at everybody and then kind of came up and then finally looked over at the defense table and she said, yes. And she was asked to point him out and she pointed out the defendant. It was something else. Like, I don't know. It was just a moment for me when that happened. I think she must have had tunnel vision. Like, she was so nervous or something that she was only focused on the person asking her questions. She hadn't looked around the courtroom yet. Okay. She, under cross-examination by Mr. Kern, she reiterated that she knew John Cranston, knew him as of the first time she drove with Shawn Cranston, December 7th. That was the first time that she met either one of them at their place at Rigby Road. She pronounced it Rigby. Took me a while to figure out what it was, but I did. But that William Byler, who was living with him, had gotten rights from John Cranston before. But prior to that, she had never met John or Shawn Cranston. The friend that she was dropped off at was Margaret Byler. She clarified a little bit the timeline of the hunting story. She said that Shawn was driving a black pickup and that she, you know, pointed out where Owen and Mary lived. And then, she was very clear about this because her, it kind of felt like, I don't know that he was purposefully trying to do it, but the defense was kind of tripping her up. And, she was like, no, this is what I saw. This is how I know. This is what he said. And this is how I know it. It was really cool. So, anyway, she was redirected. The second time he came around was he driving the red Jeep. So on the January 11th, on December 7th, he was in a black pickup. On January 11th, he was in a red Jeep. And that's the time he had the gun. She saw that he had the gun in a holster. She didn't know that it was a holster. She just knew that there was a gun on his side. On the recross, they verified that the handgun was on his hip. It wasn't a rifle. It was a handgun. She thinks it was in a holster, doesn't know the color of the gun. Said he was well-dressed. He was all in black, kind of dressed up, black sunglasses, black beanie hat, black slacks, black sport coat, wasn't wearing a tie. She sat down when she was done with the other witnesses. Now that is a good time for us to check to see what you guys are saying over here. Wow, you guys have been... Yeah, it's been going at it. So let's see if there's any. Uh, Oh no, did the kids see anything? Yeah, I mean, Andy Byler said the kids told him what happened. The little boy was 3 years old, so it would be in his level of understanding. And the little girl was 2 years old. It'd be their level of understanding. These are just little kids. But from what was testified to today, yeah, they did see it. Poor children, they would have seen or at least heard everything. Yeah, they saw and heard it all. Let's see. I just want to... The Amish locally also have their own things along the lines of the story. Oh, I don't even want to get into that stuff. I mean, you guys are welcome to discuss it, but I'm not going to get into it. Yeah. At Renee S., I'm with you. Documents and facts only. That's what I would like to stick with. But you guys are welcome to discuss that stuff. I'm gonna stick with. With the testimony of the day, okay? All right. Next guy to come in was a witness named Jonathan Matthew Santry. Non-Amish guy. Kind of looking messy and disheveled. He was sworn in at 312. He lives on South Street in Corey, and he testified that he owns the vacant lot between Shawn Cranston's place and the Dollar General, where he was arrested, and that he also owns a property behind the Cranston, so they're kind of like rear neighbors. Corey is not a big town, by the way. Most people would consider it rural. Well, maybe not most people. Most city people would consider Corey a pretty rural place. But I remember when we moved to Western Pennsylvania, people would ask me why we moved here, and we'd say, because we wanted a more rural lifestyle. And they'd go, well, then why did you move downtown? Well, the town we live in is like 4,000 people. It's rural to us, right? But anyway, Corey's kind of a small town. He knows Shawn Cranston as a neighbor. The back neighbor has known him for about 13 years. He sees his wife and son. He sees the son walking the dog a lot. She sees Shawn every now and then. He knows that his wife owns a red Jeep, that he used to own a black Chevy Silverado, but hasn't seen the truck in a couple months. The red Jeep is a Jeep Patriot. He says he sees it every day. And Santry is a mechanic. He is a car person. So he recognizes the car and identifies it for the first time perfectly. Let's see. He said that he has seen Shawn, that he usually keeps a black pistol on his hip. It's usually it was a black gun. They asked him if the gun changed, and he said that he wasn't sure if it did or not. Said that he saw him 2 days after the murder, and he wasn't sure if the gun was a different gun or not. On the 26th, he said the Jeep was not in the driveway at his house in the morning. Usually it's there in the morning. It sounds like he was out hauling Amish. That's what Mr. Santry was doing. Let's see. So on the 26th, the Jeep wasn't there in the morning, and it is usually there. And it wasn't there when he got home that day, but he saw the Jeep back at the house later that evening. 2 days later, the Wednesday, he drove Amish that morning and then talked to authorities that morning. Said troopers asked if they could look through his backyard to the backyard of the Cranstons. But while the troopers were there, that green Jeep was parked at the house, and somebody got in it and left. And so the troopers left and followed the Jeep. He said that same evening that the troopers had been there, he talked with Shawn at about 5:30 or 6 o'clock. Shawn asked about getting tires out of his backyard. He wanted 16 or 17 inch tires for his Jeep. The tires were dry rotted, but he wanted them anyway. So when asked, like, what is in your backyard? He said he's got old tires back there and he's got a tractor back there, but it's not like a junkyard. It just, you know, he's a mechanic. And so defense kind of just assumed that there might be like a scrapyard back there. He said, no, I've got some old tires and I've got a tractor back there. But apparently Shawn Cranston wanted two tires from him. So he thought it was weird because they weren't going to fit the Jeep and he only wanted two. He said, maybe if he wanted four, then okay, maybe, but they really weren't going to fit. He also noticed that he normally wore just like a baseball cap, but he was wearing a hoodie with the hood up, like to cover his identity. Actually, I think I added that last part. He didn't say to cover his identity. He just said that the hoodie was up. When the police, he said he went with the police to the impound lot after the arrest to look at the Jeep. He thinks it was Friday or Saturday. They showed him exhibit one. He said, yes, that is the car. And he sees that the two back tires on the Jeep were the ones from his property, the ones that really didn't fit the Jeep. Okay. So under cross by Mr. Kern, he did testify that he hauls Amish and that he is a mechanic and he's working at opening a garage. He's been hauling since August and the garage opened like a month ago. On the 26th, he said he left home at 5 a.m. He hauls Amish construction workers. He drops them off. Then he goes home, usually gets home around 8:30 or 9:30. And then he was in and out all day. The Jeep was not there when he got home that morning. He did not see Shawn on the 26th, the 27th. On the 28th, he got back around 9:30 a.m, talked with the PSP sometime that morning. They were there for a couple hours. PSP spoke to him and his neighbor, a guy named Alex. Said that there's a tractor with a pile of tires. He owns the empty lot. Okay, I've covered that. 12:28 evening was the first time he talked with Cranston from the time of the murder, probably around 5:30 p.m. And he said that he was really nervous talking to Cranston because the police had been there earlier that day. And so he was really nervous about it. Let's see what you guys are saying over here real quick. Let's see. Jennifer Hannah says, I want to stick with testimony for sure. I was just wondering if there was any reason given as to why he did this and why they are saying Shawn instead of John, or did I get the name right or wrong? No, there are two. There is Shawn Cranston, 52, and John Cranston, his son, John and Shawn. Okay. As to the first part of your question, we're going to get there, Jennifer. Stick with me. Thank you very much. Let's see what else here. Wisdom Sleuth 777. Jennifer, that is my biggest curiosity. What was his motive and why was it so over the top? Revenge, or is he just one of those hate-filled sociopaths? Based on his image, he's intimidating. That's a good comment. I mean, this image does make him look intimidating, but in real life, other than like the sleeve tattoos and stuff, he's not a big man. He's not a tall man. He's not imposing. He's not somebody who would intimidate me. And that's not just me being a tough guy. It's just, he just looks like an old man. But yeah, we'll get to the motive. We'll get to the discussion about the motive. Let's say that. Okay. Now that we have kind of heard from Andy and Dan and Julie and some of the rest of the folks involved in this, now this is where we get to law enforcement. The next witness is Trooper Michael, Bruneau. That's how he pronounced it. He was wearing a suit. It was really like cognitively dissonant because everybody who has testified so far is kind of like They're either Amish and they have the same haircut, the same clothes, or they are just kind of working class, you know, folks, normal folks. And then when Trooper Bruneau came in, he's wearing a suit. His hair is like cut high and tight. He looked like he came straight out of the military. It was just like, oh, okay, now we're talking to law enforcement, definitely. He said that he's part of the criminal investigation unit. He responded to the scene that day, and his task was to begin canvassing the area and collecting interviews. He interviewed William Byler at about 8 p.m., asked him if he knew John and Shawn, which he said he did. He asked how he knew them. He said they hauled him. They had contact numbers, or William had contact numbers for him, wrote them down. He had them like in a little black book. Then the police used open source resources to check the numbers so that they could get a last name for John and Shawn. And it came back as John Cranston, Shawn Cranston. Okay. Once they had the name, they conducted an NCIC query and identified them by their name and were able to get an address. On Wednesday, so 2 days after the murder, Trooper Bruneau here went and interviewed John Cranston in Titusville, confirmed that Shawn is his dad, confirmed Shawn's number and his address. While they were en route to go interview Shawn, they stopped by the Dollar General, which is pretty much next door to Shawn's house. It's like Shawn's house there on East Main Street, then an empty lot that's not very wide, then the Dollar General. So they stopped at Dollar General to get video surveillance. Turns out the cameras didn't point at his house. They weren't successful in getting anything meaningful. Then they went behind Shawn Cranston's house, and this is where his testimony meshes with the previous testimony, right? That they talked to the neighbors. They talked with Mr. Santry. They talked with a guy named Alex Capilloni, which I'm sure I didn't spell correctly. And when they had driven by Shawn's residence, they saw the red Jeep there. And by that point, the red Jeep was common information to them from interviews and so forth. So they saw the red Jeep. That's when they decided to go around and talk with the neighbors. Santry and Alex collectively indicated that Shawn Cranston did have the red Jeep Patriot, that he used to have a black pickup, but they hadn't seen it in some time. After speaking with Santry and Alex, they went to the back of the property, like Santry testified, and he saw the red Jeep leave the Cranston residence. So they got in their car and followed the Jeep toward State Route 6. There was a white non-Hispanic male with a red beanie driving it, just one person in the vehicle. He took a photo of the vehicle with his cell phone. That was entered in as prosecution exhibit number 4. They followed the vehicle to State Route 6. He made a left turn toward Union City. They eventually discontinued following him. And then they went around to different places like Elwood National Forge across the street from his residence because they saw cameras there, and they ended up getting useful video from different businesses in Corey around Cranston's house. On cross, he just asked when the photo of the red Jeep was taken. It was 1:54 p.m. and that it was noon when he interviewed John Cranston in Titusville. Titusville to Corey, I don't know, 20, 25 minutes, maybe 30 minutes. Okay. The next witness number 10, guys. At this point, I was just like, oh, come on, man. We've had a lot here. Okay, this was another state trooper. He said that he was working the shift that day, that he's a member of the forensic services unit. So when I was there and the forensic services van was there, Trooper Sedler was there. He was a member of this unit. Okay. He said that he drove down in the FSU van with another trooper and that an alternate drove down separately. His job was to examine the residence. They found shoe prints using different lighting techniques. and they found those prints in the entry room. Remember how I described there was kind of like this outer door and then an inner door to get into the house? So he found shoe prints in that entry room. Going through the room, there were more impressions that were found in the dining room and leading into the kitchen area. He took photos, said the entire scene was photographed. And then this I thought was pretty interesting. The shoe print impressions were consistent with what appeared to be a Nike Air Force One shoe. What he said. And then they went through all these exhibits. Yeah, what is this? Well, this is a photo of an impression. What is this? This is a photo of this, that, the other, right? A whole bunch of different photos that they went through. Tread pattern of shoes. And then they, on exhibit 14, oh, there was another, didn't want to skip this one. Exhibit 13 was a photo of what they suspected to be a rubber glove that was collected from the kitchen trash can, like a nitrile black rubber glove. And then exhibit 14 was a photo of a pair of red and black Nike shoes that were collected from a camper behind Cranston's residence, located at the rear of the camper. He described it as you lift up the bed and there's like a little door that you open up, and inside that compartment at the rear of the camper was this pair of Nike Air Force One shoes. The tread pattern was similar to the lifts at the crime scene. Then they went through a couple of other, photos, including another photo inside the camper in the kitchen area where there's a box of these black heavy-duty nitrile gloves with a diamond pattern on them inside that camper. And he testified that the piece of rubber that was taken from the kitchen trash at the Byler's residence appeared to him to be the same pattern and color and consistency, I guess, as the box of nitrile gloves that he, that were found in the camper. And there's more about this later on, but, he said he also learned that later that there had been a trash pull taken by another trooper from Cranston's residence, and that a black colored glove was taken from that trash, which matched the pattern of the fragment found at the crime scene as well. So you can see that we're like, it's not just circumstantial evidence here. They are gathering physical evidence as well, right? And what is the point of a preliminary hearing? It is to convince a judge that it is more likely than not that the defendant committed the crimes for which he or she is charged. It's a pretty low bar. It's just, is it more likely or less likely? Is it more likely than not or less likely than is? I'm saying this horribly, but the judge, that's what the judge is going to make a decision on. So through this testimony, they're piling on circumstance and they're piling on physical evidence. Right? Okay. Under cross-examination by Mr. Kern, he reiterated that the Forensic Services Unit has full-time members. There are four of them, has two alternates. And anytime there's a major crime, they collect evidence from the scene. He can't say that the shoe prints are a match to the shoes. He can only say that they appear similar, that a lab will have to determine if they are a match or not. Same thing with the gloves. He can say that they appear the same, but scientifically, it's the lab that has to show whether or not they are the same. He said that he was not involved in that trash pull. He does not know when it happened. And at that point, what was funny is the elderly woman, white-haired woman, who I believe is probably Cranston's mother. I don't know that, but I just kind of assumed that, I guess. She just spoke up from the gallery and was like, "Your Honor, I just need to go to the bathroom." And I mean, we had been in there a long time. It was 4:15. I had been in there since exactly 1 o'clock. Right. So it had been a while. And so, Judge Nichols was like, "Yeah, let's take a break." And we took a 15-minute break. Okay. Let's see. Not saying conspiracy law with the red Jeep picture, but was it doing something similar, something that made him feel he needed to take a picture? Well, I think that was the first time that they had encountered the red Jeep. Like the witnesses had told, they were aware that a red Jeep was spotted on the road. They were, I don't know that they had seen video yet. In fact, I'm pretty sure that they hadn't, but they were aware of this red Jeep that everybody told them about. And so going by the Cranston house and seeing a red Jeep, I think probably the reason he took that picture when he followed them, or when he followed him, was to just have like evidence here. This is a red Jeep. I think that's all it was. Like, it was entered into evidence as a Commonwealth exhibit, but I think that probably was all that it was about. Let's see. Jamie answered, I believe the red Jeep was driving up and down the road that morning multiple times. Okay. All right. So we get out of our break and we come back into the room. We're all grateful that we were able to stand up for a little while because we're all sitting on hard chairs. And the next person to be a state's witness was Trooper Kyleen Cotton. Trooper Cotton. Sorry, guys. Give me a second. Hit the wrong button. There we go. Trooper Cotton said that she is at the PSP barracks, that she's an alternate FSU. She was on scene and her duty was to process evidence outside the scene and to take photos. She was focused on tire tracks. And this is where those tires kind of come into play, okay? And then she was shown a whole bunch of exhibits. I don't know that we really need to get into all of them other than to say that she had found tire tracks. The tire tracks showed that the tread pattern showed that there was a baldness on the side of a tire. She could not say if it was the inside of the tread or the outside of the tread. She just knew that there was baldness. Hang on a second, guys. Okay. All right. So, yeah, she said she can't determine if the balding is inside or out. Somebody else will have to determine that. And then she was done with her, testimony. And then Trooper Bradley Romancic, which I doubt that I've spelled his name correctly. That was one of the very few of the ones that they didn't ask him to spell it, spell his name. He was sworn in at about 4:45. He is a PSP trooper at the Erie Barracks. He was requested to take photos of the treads of a red Jeep Patriot while undercover. He found the vehicle, took 10 photos of the passenger side tires, and noted that the vehicle was parked in a no parking zone away from where other cars were parked. It was kind of like hidden near dumpsters. It was the 29th at 4 p.m. when the photos were taken. So that would have been Thursday, right? He was shown photos of the Jeep. Yeah, these are the ones that I took. And then, he said basically that the photos showed that the tread was worn on the inside of the tire. He only looked at the passenger side, was not able to look at the driver's side because the way it was parked. Man, I wish I had. I should have brought some more fluids for me here. But they were bald on the inside, on the passenger side, front and rear. I said they were all the same make and model. Well, the two tires that he looked at were the same make and model. They were Falcon ZX ZE960ASs. So front, rear, same brand, same wear pattern. Okay. Under cross by Mr. Stern. He just said he was not able to examine the other side, confirms that front and rear tires were the same make and model. Next witness was Trooper Bradley Barnhill. He is PSP trooper, and he said that he interviewed people, collected evidence, and reviewed evidence. He said that a trash pull was taken in the early morning hours of the 29th. He was not the one who did the trash pull, but he volunteered to go through the trash. The pull itself was done by another trooper, did it about 5 a.m. on the 29th, which was garbage day. The trash bags were out in front of the house when the two bags were taken by police. He was shown some exhibits. He said that two garbage bags were pulled. One bag was full of like bags of dog feces, puppy pads, training, things like that. And the other had household trash in it. He said the one that had household trash in it, he removed a nitrile glove. It was a black glove. He said it had a specific pattern that he called a fish scale pattern. And then he described it as a triangle with a rounded edge at the bottom. So up and down and around like that. He said it's a very specific pattern. And in that area, only one manufacturer sells that glove in the area. And that he was able to match that glove to a fragment of a piece of a glove found at the crime scene. I think that he meant to say that they appeared to match, because the other guy said, well, I can't do that. The lab has to tell me if they match or not. But he said the pattern appeared to match, I guess, is what his testimony would have been. He also found a piece of T-Mobile mail found in there addressed to Shawn Cranston, another one addressed to Shawn Cranston. And he was the one that did the open source search of John and Shawn's phone numbers. I've misspelled John's name there. So that was him. Under cross-examination, he was asked to explain a little bit what a trash pull is. And he said, oh, it's really simple. 5:04 in the morning, the bags are out waiting for the garbage truck. So we go in with an undercover car. We pick up the trash bags and transported them to the quarry barracks of the state police and entered them into evidence. He said then that he can't scientifically say that the gloves match, that a lab would be responsible for making the match. And then he was done and took a seat in the courtroom. There were only one or two people who didn't stay for the rest of the hearing after their testimony. Okay, witness number 14. Guys, witness number 14, a guy named Matthew Bonin, Lieutenant Bonin. Oh, man. I really should have prepared better here. Sorry, guys. My voice is going. I wish I had a cough drop or something. You know what? Hang out for just a second. No, I'm just going to keep going. It's fine. Okay. This Matthew Bonin guy, Lieutenant Bonin, I really, really enjoyed his testimony because this was a digital forensics guy. And he prepared like a video presentation, a PowerPoint with these video presentations about information that he had analyzed. Now, he was not the person who collected the data. He was the analyst that analyzed the data. The data in question, the data that he analyzed, there were two sets of data. The first set was a dump of cell phone tower data. So they got a warrant that covered three towers in that area. And then his job was to go through that giant set of data and filter out the number that he was looking for, which was Shawn Cranston's. And then his job was to track Mr. Cranston's movements during the time frame of the data that he got from the warrant. That's number one. Number two, it turns out that Shawn Cranston was driving this red Jeep Patriot, which was a financed car. He got a loan for it. He was making payments on it. And as part of his financing agreement, a GPS tracker was installed on the Jeep. He and his wife, who bought the car, knew it. It was part of their financing agreement that they knew that there was a GPS tracker attached to the Jeep. Okay. Now, how did the state police know about the GPS tracker? Well, they didn't until the finance company, after seeing that Jeep hadn't moved and in looking at it at Google Maps could see that it was an impound lot, called the state police for the purpose of repossessing the vehicle. And that is when the police were like, you have GPS data on this, and they got the GPS data from the finance company. And I don't know if they got a warrant for it, if it was just voluntarily given. I don't know. But those were the two pieces of data. Okay. Cell phone tracking and GPS tracking. And then this guy, let me get over to my notes here so you guys can see it. This guy used this mapping software that's provided by the FBI to map the data. And he did this whole description about what, about the directionality of the cell towers, what directions the antennas go in, what the speed of the radio signal is going back and forth. He described what your cell phone is doing as it's constantly looking for the best signal, why they talk to towers so much, and why they had so much data. Basically, what he was able to show the court is that at 8:41 a.m., Cranston was at his home. At 9:05 a.m., he was near the Byler's home. At 9:09 a.m., he was very, very close to the Byler's farm. And at 10:07 a.m., he was at the Byler's farm, like in the driveway. It pinpointed it there. When he got the data from the cell phone company, which would basically give this arc of distance, and then he put on top of that the GPS data, it just got him right to the Byler's residence. And then 10:11, the Jeep is a short distance away. 10:15, the Jeep is back at the Byler residence. 10:17, the Jeep leaves the residence, travels northeast, and goes toward Corey, and he puts the Jeep in Corey at 10:48. And then he said for the purpose of the preliminary hearing, he didn't bring all of the data. He brought the morning data and he brought the evening data, but that it would take more time to analyze all of the data, but that he has all of the data. So, and you know, again, what's the purpose of the preliminary hearing? Just to make the judge decide whether this moves to the common pleas court or not. Okay. So he puts the GPS, puts the vehicle home at 6:26 that day. He did testify that the data that he had is not consistent with his cell phone ever being turned off during the day. It's just that that's when he actually talked about, I have all the other data, I just am not showing it here. And then he talks about the GPS coordinates were at the police station where the Jeep was seized, and that's how the finance company knew to call. Under cross, Mr. Kern asked if the GPS data was related to the cell phone. He said it was not. It was all that GPS tracker. This goes back to my iron law, man. This goes back to my iron law. This guy was trying to get away with, like, he, as we go into other witnesses, we're going to see that he's trying to hide the crime. At least that's what it looks like. Let me put it that way. My opinion is that the evidence appears that to show that he was trying to cover up the crime. Innocent until proven guilty, all that, right? But like there's more that's coming on this, I guess. It's just, yeah. Okay. Let's get into Trooper Hubbard here. So Trooper Hubbard was sworn in at 5:30. He is part of the criminal investigation unit there at the Corey Barracks. He attended Rebekah Byler's autopsy, and poor Andy during this time, man. This trooper did such a good job not going into details for the purpose of sparing Andy Byler, I think. he kept it very germane to just the purpose of a preliminary hearing. He said that he observed her deceased both on scene and at the autopsy. He said that Dr. Eric Vey, who I mentioned in a previous video, conducted the autopsy, Dr. Vey is a pathologist, a forensic pathologist with like over 5,000 autopsies that he's performed. He does all of this work for basically Northwest PA. Including Crawford County. So he works in the Erie County Coroner's Office, and he did the autopsy. Vey's opinion was that the cause of Rebekah Byler's death is a multiple sharp force injury wounds to the neck, and a gunshot wound to the head. So, and that was very, very clear. So she died from multiple sharp injury wounds to her neck and a gunshot wound to her head. They didn't mention anything about the scalping thing in this. Probably because they didn't have to, right? It's not a trial. It's a preliminary hearing. Okay. The cause of Rebekah Byler's unborn child's death was described as intrauterine fetal demise due to the mother's demise. And he aged the baby between 21 and 25 weeks along. And what is that? My math is really, really bad, but let's say 21 divided by 4. So 5.5 to 6 months along, let's say. Okay. Out of 40 weeks. Yeah. So she was close to the third trimester. She was at the end of her second trimester. All right. He testified that the death was inside the living room of the residence on Fish Flats Road. He testified that the 911 call audio is in evidence, that it'll be part of discovery. Call time was 12:20, and then it was transferred to PSP Corey, who entered the time as 12:26. He testified no medical care was given, that she was deceased upon arrival. He testified about receiving the phone call from the finance company about the GPS. The GPS device is still on the Jeep, he said. He talked about they'd been applied for and given 3 search warrants, one to impound the vehicle, one for a DNA test from Mr. Cranston, and one to process the vehicle. Said the Jeep was impounded on the 1st of March, and when it was, the rear tires had been changed. They no longer matched what was there when the other trooper took the photos undercover. Of course, Santry told them all about the tires, right? Said there was surveillance footage from the Sportsman Club down the road from the Byler's home, from a car wash across the street from Cranston's home, from the forge across the street from Cranston's house, and from a tree service truck. They actually played video in the hearing from the Sportsman Club showing the Jeep passing by, showing the horse and buggy passing by, showing the white pickup truck with the green trailer with the Amish buggy on it passing by, and they entered that into footage. And then, guys, the most difficult thing to watch was them trying to show us these videos. It was painful. It was like there were 9 of my grandmothers all huddled around a computer trying to play a video. It took forever. But we did watch some video. We watched, in addition to the Sportsman Club, we also watched car wash video where he pulls into the car wash area to pay for a car wash, goes into the car wash tunnel, vacuums the car. He vacuums himself. And in that video, he is wearing those Nike shoes that they found. Well, he appears to be wearing shoes that match the Nike shoes that were found in that camper. He arrived back at his house at 2:02 in the afternoon. What did I write here? The Forge security video is played mercifully for us. They let the trooper operate the video player. Yeah, I'd had enough, man. I'd had enough. Where did I write down? Is it coming up or let me see. I wrote down. Oh, it's coming up. Okay. So, he shows us all this video. And then, like, for 3 hours, Shawn Cranston is seen. He pulls his car behind his home. So it's kind of behind the home and the camper. The hatch is open. It's actually open and closed multiple different times. But during that time, he's just taking stuff out of the car and taking it over towards the direction of the camper. We can't see if he's going into the camper because he is hidden from view by the camper. But we also start to see smoke from behind the camper, like he's lit a fire. So he's storing stuff in the camper and he's destroying some stuff by fire is what it looks like. I mean, they'll have to prove that that is what happened, but that's what the evidence looks like. Let's see. Then there's a bunch of screen grabs that were admitted into evidence. The, you know, screen grab from all the videos. And then under cross-examination, Kern asks him about the gunshot wound and asks him if they've ever located a firearm, to which he said they haven't. He actually said, "We're still looking for the firearm." So then he asks about the sharp instrument wounds and asks if they've found the sharp instrument. He says they have not found it. Okay. Now this is coming back to what you were saying before, wisdom, right? So the Commonwealth rests. The defense calls no witnesses, but they have a quick argument to make. The argument that they make, guys, is that the prosecution in all of this has not offered any motive and has not offered any murder weapon. So we sat in that courtroom for 5.5 hours. And I mean, I wanted to know what the motive was in this. Why would Shawn Cranston have stabbed Rebekah Byler multiple times in the neck and shot her in the head? Why? I mean, I think that's a question that we all want to know the answer to, right? Why? And they gave no answer to that. There is no answer to that. No motive, no murder weapon. And because they have no motive and no murder weapon, he says the case should be dismissed. The evidence is completely circumstantial. But Judge Nichols was like, so quick. She's like, no, the prosecution has made their case. It has met the burden. This case will proceed in its entirety to the Court of Common Pleas. And she closed the session right there. It was 6:44 when she did that. I don't know that I've ever been happier to stand up, but that was the preliminary hearing. Now, we were prohibited from doing any type of interviewing or talking to anybody, interviewing anybody while on the grounds of the judicial center. We were prohibited from taking pictures close to the judicial center, stuff like that. So, I didn't talk to anybody. And honestly, I don't think I would have anyway. I think that they had been through enough that day. But that is where the case is. So what happens now? Okay, in the state of Pennsylvania, there are three levels of criminal courts, basically. Three levels of courts that handle criminal cases. They're not solely criminal courts. But the first level is the magisterial district court, and that's what we're working with here. Judge Nichols is a magisterial district judge. It is the lowest of judgeships. You don't have to be a lawyer. You don't have to be a trained judge to be a magisterial judge. Many of them are. Judge Nichols might be. I don't know. But once it goes through the magistrate, the next place it goes is the Court of Common Pleas. The Court of Common Pleas is your standard, run-of-the-mill, what you'd expect by watching TV criminal court. The judges in Pennsylvania are elected to their positions. They're elected to 10-year positions, and then every 10 years they go on the ballot whether to retain them or not. It's very uncommon for a judge to not be retained. So these are professional judges that spend sometimes 30, 40 years on the bench. When we go over to the UJS case and we see on the docket, the magisterial docket, that the status is closed right here. Get you up in there. That means that it is done in the magisterial district court and it now is going to be headed to the Court of Common Pleas. I don't know what's going to happen at this point. Will Mr. Cranston plea? Well, out of the somewhere between 1,200 to 1,500 cases that a court in a county like Crawford County will hear in a year, only about 8 or 9 of them will make it to trial. So the chances are that he probably will plea on this. But if he goes to trial, then the trial will be held there, probably in courtroom number one of the Judicial Center. It'll be done by one of the higher judges there in Crawford County, because that's a county I don't live in or typically report from. I really don't know their names, but that's where it'll go. And if it goes to trial, he will be tried by a jury of his peers from Crawford County. Let's see if there are any other things that you guys brought up that you want me to comment on. What did you make of the defendant's body language? He made almost no movement the entire time, and I had a direct view of him. He made almost no movement the entire 5.5 hours we were there. He never spoke. He never whispered to his counsel. He never leaned over. He was just sitting there the entire time. That's a good question. People are giving me compliments. Thank you very much. Don says psychopaths never need a motive. Hey, let's see. Don, I think you're right. In this case, they obviously don't need to show a motive in order to make it to the next level of court, right? I guess from my, like, I was really hoping for one, maybe just for my own satisfaction. Like, I'm just curious why, you know, but you're right. It's often we don't get that satisfaction. That's why they're so scary. No rhyme or reason. Yeah. Let's see. Okay. Wait a minute. What? Keegan Swanson. Gavin, I sat in front of you. Were you one of the reporters, Keegan, or were you with the family? Yeah, because I was seated. Yeah, I don't know, but I'm glad to see somebody who was in court today is here on the live stream. Thank you for joining. And yeah, you should introduce yourself, Keegan. I heard as I walked into the lobby. I was in the lobby. I had been there for a few minutes. It had quieted down some, and then just to kind of get the lay of the land, because I had never been to the Justice Center, I was kind of walking around just to see where the courtrooms are and stuff like that. And I walked in front of the group of people that ended up being seated in front of us that I think were Mr. Cranston's family. And I heard somebody whisper, "That's Gavin Fish." So was that you, Keegan? I ignored it because I didn't want to engage because of the decorum order, right? But I have done some local reporting, some pretty extensive local reporting on this. I imagined that they recognized from my reporting. This is a good question. L.M. Hitchcock, no grand jury or the magistrate take care of that. So, in the Commonwealth, there are some times when a grand jury is convened. But I'm not quite sure why they do it sometimes and why they don't do it other times. The vast majority of times we don't see a grand jury. We see the magistrate and then it goes on from there. But I know in other states, like in Mississippi, for example, in the Kirby Carpenter case, like they're waiting, the suspects have been in custody since November, waiting for the next grand jury, which convenes in April. So I know every state does it very differently. Nancy asked, did they check under her nails for any DNA? When you're taking notes there in the hearing, I'm sure I missed tons of stuff. They did get a warrant for DNA, And they had mentioned DNA in other documents that we've gotten in the case that you can read on my website. But they didn't specifically mention that in the preliminary hearing, whether they got DNA off of her or from the scene or anything at all. All we know is that they got his DNA. I would imagine, well, oh, in the search warrant return, there were something like 37 swabs that they took from the crime scene. So I imagine that those would be for DNA, but I don't know specifically under her nails. I don't know. That is, and Jamie, yeah, it is a good question, Jamie, isn't it? Hey guys, I've noticed, I have noticed a lot of super chats and I appreciate those deeply. Thank you very much for those. My dream is to be able to do this full time, be a full-time YouTuber and cover true crime because it's something that I love. So that makes that possible. Another thing that makes that possible are my patron supporters who their main perk that they get is they get access to the document, all the documents on my website. And I deeply thank all of you who support me either with super chats or super stickers or through Patreon, or there are some people that even give me donations on my website. I deeply, deeply appreciate it. Thank you for doing that. I have to sign off because I have to write up my report on this hearing for the company that I work for. So I'm going to call it a night. Thank you very much for joining me tonight, and I will see you on the next one. Take care. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please consider subscribing. And if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below.